Slided out the map.
Yeah, they're saying like he slided all the way back home and then came right back to the jungle again. An awkward interaction. I'm sure that only happens a few times here. But it looks like we actually have our Game 2 draft underway here. I do want to go ahead and remind you guys, be sure to go check out g2a.com/DotaPit. They are giving away graphics cards, Dota cosmetics, and some AMD processors. So be sure to go check that out. Oh, super nice. There we go. Yeah. Let's get into the game.
Evil geniuses, right out of the bat,
they got to get rid of the Pudge.
It's going to get banned out.
I think that's perfectly warranted after that last game. I think even sometimes if a player is that comfortable on a Pudge, it can just be a hero that you don't want to play against. It's something you don't play against too often, and it's just, you know, those hooks can be super, super devastating in laning phase. They never let EG get online and get their five-man ball lineup, and then even if they did, let's say that they did have a better lane setup, you still have to deal with getting hooked into the base. So Pudge ban, definitely appropriate.
I mean, it feels like that was something premeditated by Faceless. I just like had to hop on Black's profile. He had been pubbing with Pudge the past 2 days pretty rigorously. So I feel like it was something premeditated. They were coming in like, we're going to have this Pudge game and we're going to go well. So they have to expect that it was going to get banned out here in game number two. EG, though, not changing things up already at the start. It looks like they're going to be snagging up what looks like the Universe Underlord once again.
I mean, I think this is fine from EG. You know, I don't think you kind of look at your own draw and say that it was the issue. You look at the fact you let Black play Pudge and you say that was the issue. No. You know, Underlord, it you know, didn't do anything amazing, but you can't put that down to the hero to Universe. It was just the fact that Faceless played so well against it.
I don't feel like he got to play the Underlord. He got to like do what the Underlord does. Yeah. Group up, push towers, and just group. He was never able to do that versus the side of Faceless.
Are we gonna see the nuts Witch Doctor right out of the bat once again? Last time they didn't really have to wait too long to make that kind of early commitment. Obviously, this time they won't have the illustrious Pudge to follow it up with, so that could be a bit of a changer, but very intrigued already to see what Faceless are going to be opening with right out of the gate.
I was going to say, I guess, why not?
I mean, he had a good showing with it. It's a classic, you know, as Park was saying before, he's known to play this hero since his time back on MVP.
Yep.
And just something that he knows that he can kind of bring his A game.
And we did see some, you know, good cast bounces last game because EG were wanting to group up and push. You know, they are going to want to stand close to the Underlord. So cast is an instant answer to that.
Yep. Strong laner, he's kind of coming back into the meta more. Good versus Underlord.
But do you think they should go down that road again where, you know, if they're anticipating EG are going to go again back to the five man, and it looks like they may here,
again.
You know, do you go down that road of what we felt like was almost too much single target? The benefit of having that almost too much single target was they're able to roam around, they're able to catch those stragglers, those people trying to split up and farm, they're able to isolate, pick, and take advantage of. So I wouldn't be surprised if Faceless, I don't know if they want to go back to the Invoker, but they could add on top of this Nyx more global presence. But oh my gosh, here it is, the crit Earth Spirit. I mean, this hero's already had a fantastic showing here at Dota Pit. Crit is ridiculously good on the hero. He's shown that since his time on OG, and here it is now.
I like that they just go for the Nyx again. Yeah, it's probably the top two heroes that he's been playing recently, even since Boston. Everybody was just talking about this guy's Nyx. When he gets it, it's like, this is a completely different Faceless that you're playing versus. Yeah. Good to grab it up. Just lots of presence. Good team fight on the map. Earth Spirit, Evil Geniuses, definitely different. A little bit more of a switch up, but more team fight and a little bit more aggression coming out of them this time.
I start considering hoods, pipes. I don't know. There's already a lot of heavy team fight, heavy magical presence here coming out from EG.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be curious to see how Faceless are going to be looking to counter that potential ridiculous team fight now. An already great initiation provided by the Earth Spirit. But they'll move on forward. Bans out on the Shadow Demon. EG again, kind of replicating their bans from game one. Get rid of the Jug once again in second phase.
Yeah, they've been playing it a lot. It's very good versus Underlord and Earth Spirit in the laning phase and through the later stages with that natural built-in magic resistance from Spin. SD ban. We did see it banned from EG in the first two the last time, so not too much of a surprise to see that one being taken up on play faces here, so EG doesn't get like an SD Luna or something along those lines.
Only got the Luna last time without the SD. Could we see Arteezy on that Luna once again if they're favoring that five man?
I think it's possible. It fits super well with the Underlord, and you're not playing versus Pudge this time, so you're not.
That's true.
Squishy carry versus Pudge hooks.
Also curious to see what they're going to look to put Sumail on, too. Mm. I don't know if you go right back for the Ember Spirit.
I mean, I think he definitely could still pick the Ember.
You could.
Yeah.
Maybe, I mean, that's the thing. Sumail might be that kind of a player, but he's like, give it to me again. I want to run back. I want to show that that game one was just a fluke, and I want to go ahead and just kind of show my fans how I play.
They've got a lot of diversity amongst their lineup, though. Like, all of them can play an immense amount of heroes, so it's definitely possible that you could pick it, but picking it into Nyx is also not always the most favorable. But still, yeah, he could still just grab it anyway. Because it's a natural Veil Builder lately, and they already, like we were mentioning, have lots of spell damage on the side of Evil Geniuses.
Mm-hmm. Also saw that Shadow Fiend was out of the picture as well. EG will rid of the Weaver. He said it wasn't too big of an impact in game number one, but something that still feels a bit concerning to EG right now.
Mm-hmm. Does Faceless want to show now? I did show their first two supports super early last time, but this time, probably going to reserve it a little bit more, since we're probably going to see Black playing back on the carry. He's not playing the Pudge. I think it's quite exclusive when they switch with that one, right? I think it's usually just when he's playing Pudge.
Yeah, I think most of the other times they keep out. Other members do switch around. We've seen, I think it's Nuts and Jabs sometimes switch positions, depending on the mid they're able to get.
I'm getting this like inkling of a Black Slark. I think that feels a bit too far out of a field here. I know it's too early to call in the draft, but...
The Underlord, the aura is very annoying if you're Slark, because, you know, a lot of your damage is built up from the stats and the Essence Shift, and Underlord just cuts that, you know, fractions that off with the aura.
Sand King.
All right, well, you got your team fight now. You got your initiation, fight. Extra stun to go along with the Nyx here.
Heavy magic damage to deal with the Underlord, so you don't have to worry about so much the Atrophy aura so much.
And overall could be a strong laning presence if they do kind of get him against a favorable matchup in that lane.
Look, I keep seeing this, like, Sand King versus Underlord in this, like, safe lane, like, kind of battling versus each other since Underlord's been released.
And how does that matchup typically work out?
I thought it was going to be very Sand King heavy, but Underlord seems to do just fine. You just bring yourself a couple things of regen, and, yeah, you're kind of okay just spamming with your Firestorm. You both kind of pressure each other to not go near the creep wave, because it's like, oh, I don't want to walk near it because there's Caustic. I don't want to walk near it because there's Firestorm. So
they'll both like kind of take the win-win, I guess, in that case.
Yeah, it's kind of even. I think maybe a little Sand King favored, but Underlord also is just so innately tanky that he can just deal with those Caustics. So
I guess it depends on which half of the map the lane ends up being. Because if they do have, if they do just get it on the standard off lane, he's going to have easy access to the Shrine, which is going to be very useful as the Underlord. Just allowing you to spam a bit more, head back and rinse and repeat, and just bully the supports out of lane.
Okay, well, looks like we'll have our
Zy Wisp.
They'll crit. Zone is a notoriously amazing Wisp player. I would obviously imagine him being on the Earth Spirit, though.
Yeah.
We haven't seen Zy play Wisp since one of the older editions of EG.
Yeah, kind of in the original EG. The original Zy form of EG. It used to be very good with the Zaya.
Remaining. Does make me a bit intrigued to see what kind of possible pairings EG are going to be considering with it.
Yeah.
Maybe even with the Sumail here. I don't know if like OD.
OD maybe? I mean, out. I kind of like to see him play the TA this game.
OD versus Nyx?
That's true. Right, that's true.
A lot of lockdown as well for him. I think, yeah, the TA. He's been having great performances, at least when last time that we saw them. China top, he went completely berserk on TA.
Ursa could be very strong as well. You've got the control to kind of allow the Ursa to go to work because of the Underlord and Earth Spirit's team fight.
Now, this was banned in the last game here.
Yeah, and Jabs Tinker.
We hear about it often. Jabs Tinker. Now going to be showing itself here in game number two.
Faceless going for a lot of just comfort picks, it seems. They're just like, these are the heroes that we like, so yeah, we're going to take them. We got our Nuts Witch Doctor, we got our Ice Nyx, now we're getting our Jabs Tinker. Last game we had our Black Pudge. We're just going with our comfort across the board. And it's more magic damage to deal with the Underlord, so you don't, not worrying about Atrophy at all with these four heroes. They both don't really care about that. And it's a lot of burst damage coming out from this lineup already into the Wisp.
I feel that there's still a chance he could still play the Ember Spirit.
It's good. The spirits are all quite good versus Tinker because you can find him in a way, so that could be a possibility.
I just want to say it was a bit intriguing, the Wisp pick into the Witch Doctor. Gotta be careful about that. Coconut's very good. It's those tethered targets right there. And they do go for the TA. Nice call right there. And as you mentioned, Sumail has shown that he's very, very good on this hero.
Yeah, it's one of those calls as well that's, it's kind of hard for Nyx to do something about, especially because he's not got the backup of a potential Sunstrike coming through. You know, with the refraction, the only thing you got to worry about massively at the moment is, I guess, the Sandstorm and standing in the march, but having the backup of the Zaya, it's very, very strong here.
Yeah, so I can just like sit around the mid lane and just stack crazy for this Templar Assassin and just enable and accelerate Zai, or enable Sumail to just go crazy.
What does that mean for the lanes, though, for EG? Because you have Urspirit, who's typically known to roam about and try to look to take initiative at the start, and then Io, who's typically going to be paired with at least one. Is that going to be a bit concerning for one of EG's lanes, that they might be kind of stranded on their own a bit? I don't know if that means that Arteezy is going to have to consider, or they're going to have to consider for Arteezy more defensive heroes, or at least heroes that can at least pull out of trouble.
Yeah, definitely, because Urspirit and Wisp, you look at these two heroes, and they're both kind of heroes that kind of move between the lanes. They're not like these static laners that just do well in the lane. They need to be able to cause havoc around the map. So one of the lanes will definitely suffer, but that's usually like they can just throw Universe in that situation, or maybe go for some type of like aggro thing and put the 1v1 matchup that we were kind of talking about before.
Yeah.
So they ban out the Luna. What are the big ones that stand out?
How's Artur gonna play?
Lifestealer, okay, yep. So they have the Infest combo with the Urspirit. And it's just, since there's such heavy magic damage oriented on the side of Faceless, the range is very good versus it.
Very little ways you can kill a Lifestealer through Rage here. Death Ward pretty much been the only option, but so many ways that EG can stop Nuts getting a full channel of that out.
So it's looking like we're waiting for the black hero here from Faceless right now. You see a Lifestealer before you, actually see the whole EG lineup here before you right now.
I wonder if they're tempted, because we saw yesterday Slark work.
Still could be Slark.
Slark could work here.
Can weave enough, but it's only really the Urspirit who deals with him. Great. Like Pit can be kind of annoying, but Urspirit is the only one who really can do that. And they're already going for a Tinker who like wants to delay the game and split it up, and that's kind of what Slark wants to do with their Nyx Assassin as well. So they have a lot of ways to get information on the map if they do want to go for a Slark. I'm trying to think what other
Band
heroes.
Fighters who can fend off a Lifestealer.
Yeah.
This might be way out of left field, but like Dusa?
Yeah, no. They go with a Slark. I mean, Slark. It's...
Okay, Comfort. We were mentioning Faceless wants to do Comfort. Yeah. This is just bleeding Comfort.
I'm sure there's probably Faceless looking at yesterday going, look, it won a game, OG trash with it. We really want to play the Slark. They get it through.
And as I said, like when I was looking over Black's recent games, it was mostly Pudge and then some games of Slark. It's all about Comfort. It's all about them knowing. It feels like very premeditated again from Faceless. They came here going, game one, we're going to pull up, you know, do a Pudge kind of a lineup in game two. We'll try to creep in something like the Jabs Tinker that they might sleep on, and then we'll just give Black that Slark he'd been kind of practicing with here.
That's strong.
All right, guys, here's our draft. What's our predictions? We were all incorrect for game number one.
I like the way Faceless played the last game. I think they went for Comfort Heroes again this game. I'm going to go for Faceless this time, even though they're versus this Underlord and Crit Earth Spirit. I'm feeling it.
I think Faceless has got a good draft, but I can't go against what EG have. Okay. Because of that Earth Spirit, there's some male TA, there's some real, real strong hard hitters there that they should be, I feel, a lot more comfortable with playing than EG's last draft. This is more kind of classic EG.
Sounds great. All right. If Faceless are able to pull out one more win, they're going to be moving on to the semifinals, and EG could find themselves in the scary best of one lower bracket. Let's see if EG can stay alive and take it to a game number three. Let's throw it over to our casters right now. It's Toby-Wan and Gods.
Yeah, let's find out. Will it actually be a game three? EG's draft, Gods, I gotta say, it looks solid, it looks steady, and Faceless doesn't have that kind of weird, quirky kind of combination that would throw them off balance.
Yeah, this is a more straight-up draft from Faceless. The Tinker, I guess, the one kind of stand-up pick, but this is not something you're caught by surprise by if you're EG. You know Jabs plays it a lot, it's one of his best heroes, and it's something you're just gonna have to deal with. There's fairly little catch as the one concern for EG. They're going to be very heavily reliant on Crit's Earth Spirit to get those picks and deal with, I mean, the entire lineup can be very elusive. Nyx and Sand King have escaped, so does Slark. Tinker is just someone you've got to catch on to, and Earth Spirit is pretty much the entire catch of this team. TA traps can be useful as far as giving vision, maybe an Underlord Pit of Malice, but overall it's the Crit Earth Spirit that has to step up and have a big game.
Well, if he can do it, Earth Spirit has been, well, he was a huge star yesterday. We'll see if he can beat one today. Faceless, so it's going to be pretty similar for their offlane. Obviously, it's going to be almost exactly the same. Nyx Assassin going up onto that top lane. He won't be up against any kind of Underlord shenanigans this time around. It will be Arteezy, who's almost in a... He's actually just in a solo role up here as a Lifestealer. So EG commits Smell to the mid, and then down to bottom lane. Zai, Universe, and Crit are all going to start on the offlane.
We'll see some side pulls here, I imagine, from the Earth Spirit. Io... perhaps helping out a little bit as well. They want to try and pressure the lane of the Slark. So it's something we've been seeing more and more, and partly why Slark hasn't had much success this tournament and just in general, is that his laning stage is very, very weak. And that's something that we are looking to punish.
From bottom lane, Universe, well, the rolling boulder comes forward from Crit, but XY just tanks it. And, well, you still have that Burrow Strike available going through on Universe. Zai, the tether is there, but is there enough damage? Universe is so low, wow, they will be able to survive it.
Black was one right click away from the kill with that Essence Shift. Really nicely played. The Sand King making sure Witch doesn't get caught there. They do immediately Shrine up. This is why these aggro tri lanes are so effective. You've got that Dire Shrine so close to the tower there, immediately back in lane, full HP again. And suddenly it's Faceless who are using their consumables and lower on HP, on mana. They're the ones who are suddenly kind of at a disadvantage in this lane. They don't have a shrine. Their shrine's way over near the mid lane, and that's a shrine that's more normally reserved for the mid player, the Tinker.
Mm-hmm. And this isn't a bad thing for them too, like you trigger that shrine that early on. The offlane, like Nyx Assassin, isn't really one of those heroes that you're looking to see rotate early. And neither is the Tinker. Tinker will want to wait as well, so they're not going to be really pressured with a heavy push into the T1 tower like when you're with a Terrorblade or a Luna line up on Faceless, so it's not as bad for them.
Mid lane, Jab's getting a bit of pressure coming his way. We'll be okay. Tanking used the shrine. I don't know if that was an intentional play, but Jab's
right on top lane. Rolling boulder forward. The stun came in for the Nyx Assassin. He doesn't have anything really left, and well, that'll be the death of Ice. He actually went all out on him. He went for both Feast as well as Open Wounds. No rage to fight up against the Nyx Assassin. And they already had a bit of a tussle before that rotation in from Crit.
Ice is one of the probably one of the best offlaners when he gets 1v1 matchups, but it was Arteezy baiting him knowing that the Oath Spirit was TPing in, so very good play from Arteezy and Crit to combo up on that one. And that will give Arteezy a nice little boost to his laning stage.
It's nice for him. If they can keep the rotations up here too, this means, one RT's going to feel more comfortable, but two, that means Black's going to get a lot more space on this bottom lane, a lot more dangerous for Universe. Without the Earth Spirit, without the Io, he doesn't survive this bottom lane. So they need to try and throttle the wave back, but Universe already did the pull over, so it's really good experience for him, really good lane control.
Yeah. And Black will try and get some of these last hits as...
Well, that was confident XY, as he needs to run himself out of here. He's got a Power Strike available. He needs a little bit more distance, closer towards the ramp, and maybe gets away, but Crit's right behind him, so Zai, no support coming over, and he wasn't going to make it to the Shrine. Not with enough damage. So XY will die, but Universe will also be forced to TP back to base.
Very, very good start for the lanes for EG. All three lanes being won in terms of overall CS. The supports of Faceless just haven't really been able to get all too active. If they'd gotten that first blood earlier on the Underlord, could have been a very different outcome for the laning stage for them, but as we see Underlord winning his lane against a Slark. Slark with just 7 CS only. Black is having a very rough time, and this is with the supports having vacated this bottom lane.
Yep.
This Underlord having the early levels, the brown boots, the poor man shield means you can't really go on him. He's just going to trade hits with you, and that's a battle you kind of lose thanks to the Underlord aura.
To Black and shift his entire essence, then maybe he could fight, but that'll take a while. Yeah, this game just seems to be a lot more in favor of EG. Like the early rotation that comes in from Crit, it's so different to what happened in game one. In game one, it was all about Faceless. They would start the rotation, then EG would have to react. This time around, it's EG that starts the rotation and Faceless reacting, but not with real great coordination.
Universe is there to snag Jabs' rune, and that was a rune he really needed.
The rolling boulder forward, Crit's gonna get the kick as well. He may have just enough damage to kill off Jabs. Shrine, it will not be activated, but Jabs will be kept alive, not just to help out with a voodoo restoration.
Yeah, I don't know. I think using that shrine earlier really hurts Tinker's mid lane. Like, it was just a solo Sand King shrining up. Definitely one of those things which mid players will yell at you in pub games if you do these solo shrines as a support. And you can kind of see there, the Tinker gets going on, he survives, but he has to walk all the way back to base, then TP out. It's a lot of wasted time for the mid player of Faceless.
Yeah, and this is something Faceless really didn't want to have happen. This is going to delay his timing for his BTs. Top lane, Ice being forced again out of this top lane. Went for a different build too on his Nyx Assassin. No heavy mangoes, only the tangos, having the PMS and the boots. And he had to trigger his own shrine as well.
Yeah, he just wants to try and get that level 6 ideally so he can start moving, as well as the arcane boots if he can get enough creeps to his tower. Lane's starting to shape up a little bit better now, but Jab's getting gone on mid again.
They need help. Nuts is there with the paralyzing cast, going to bounce back and forward, keeping Samael and Crit off the Tinker. XY won't get there in time for the Burrow Strike on Samaos. No, there's no real follow-up anyway. Jams is an empty bottle, going for March plus Laser primarily. And with this is more of just a control, keep him off the lane until he can pick up his extra levels and items.
Nuts has been very good with his positioning. He's saved Tinker now on multiple occasions. He's been just a very good defensive player. Tanking XY struggled to find places to really get active. He's still level 2, so just a level 1 Burrow Strike, and Crit has really had his number as far as the early game rotations go. Pretty hard to play the Sanking in that 4 position roaming support, even with the boots first, and we're kind of seeing it here, very under-leveled, not even level 3 just yet, and kind of unable to find too many pickoffs or opportunities for Faceless early on.
Isaias has always been poked and prodded on this offlane. That level progression he had previously, obviously, like, just doesn't exist in this game.
Yeah, he's able to get active soonish. Yeah, the Arcane Boots coming soon, a couple hundred gold. If he can get there without dying, that's going to help him out a lot. Just have to worry about the support rotation coming his way.
You say without dying, he just crossed over the river, but I don't promise. Yeah, with no Dire Observer Ward up on this hill next to the tower, they don't find the opening straight away, so they roll in, Spy Caps by a little bit of time. Crit's waiting for the attack. XY, it's a perfect kick, actually, kick from Crit. Now the Paralyzing Cards and the Fire Strike with Maledict. The Lesson needs some damage. There was the Iron Fall first. Nyx Assassin barely surviving out of range of the Infest damage. So it ends up being a 1-for-1 trade-off because the Tinker died in the meantime in the mid lane to Sumail.
Yeah, that's a solo kill. Sumail, he's back. He's upset after last game, and he's ready to turn things around. He'll even have his bottle refilled by Zai's TP in, so Sumail with a nice play there to get himself on the board and get to keep this Tinker down. Yep, just being put under a good amount of pressure from the EG mid player. And Nyx now with Arcane Boots, level 6, can to make that first move.
And if he can get out there, and he has to move in this game. He needs to create space for XY to farm on the top.
I'm going to help out Black at bottom lane with his Vendetta, but Universe has already moved off the lane.
To babysit the runes. Dire's going to try and come in, and yeah, he'll deny it. No easy combinations for Ice, no Sunstrike, so he needs to get in close with another hero.
It seems Universe is aware. He's backed off, not even finishing off his neutral camp, which is a big sign that he seems well aware of what this Nyx Assassin is up to. So Ice will go on a bit of a just roaming mission, see what he can find in the jungle, and we'll find this Earth Spirit here.
Vendetta's running out, however, so he doesn't have that big burst damage he was looking for.
Yeah, he can get down some wards, which is a nice outcome. He knows there's not going to be dire defensive wards in this area, so he can plant these kind of unnoticed. We get both of these down, we'll see Crit again, and this will give Faceless some good vision to play with in the mid-game.
And goodbye, Observer Ward. So Zai claims that. Universe going back to his farm, but once again we're seeing this big group up from EG. I understand they're trying to ensure themselves a little bit of farm, but seems like the spacing is just a little bit more advantageous for Faceless.
Yeah, they're a bit more spread out. I guess EG are likely just kind of scared of this Nyx Assassin roaming. Speaking of which, he's found them once again, very close to a courier. Going Sumail too easily. He's level 10, and if he's ever got the refraction up, you're not finding that kill, but he will make his way down towards the bottom lane and look for someone like Zai on the Sayo.
And he's able to find him. Hits the Vendetta, lands the stun, and he does the mana burn, but one more hit will do it, and Black jumping forward on top of Universe. The pit is down, and Universe is already bailing. He's going all the way home, and then we'll keep you back out.
That's what damage you can. Pistol pick off. Slarker free a lane as well, he kind of create some space there. And overall it looks like things are shaping up a little bit better. They've been able to give Sanking some farm and experience in the offlane while the Nyx has been roaming, which is a big part of Ice leaving the lane. He's being a lot more active than last game on the Nyx because he's got teammates who are struggling in the support role. So recognizing that the Sanking needs to get more, he's making that space. But overall, it's EG looking very good with Sumail hitting a Blink Dagger at 10 minutes in. He's just been farming Ancients, playing the efficiency game. He's so good on this TA, and something which Faces are going to have to start addressing as he starts to pull further and further ahead on overall farm.
I don't know if ISISI knows. He didn't get any vision on Zion crit, but they were so close to him. Yep, Nuts being initiated on. Samael's actually going to find that kill. The laser, the rockets won't do enough. Zion will tether forward. That laser need to come out just a little bit earlier to stop the damage going into the Witch Doctor.
Bottom lane, meanwhile, Universe needs to be a little bit careful.
Black wants to initiate in, but there's your first stun. Jump forward with that pounce, they leash him up, and Universe wants to keep fighting. Shadow Dance is available, so Black jumping forward. He doesn't have that dark pack available, he's one more hit, and actually with the dark pack, he'll get it. But the cost is the male who TP'd himself in, blinks further forward. That Mel Strike destroys Black. So a double kill for him. And there's two cores that Samael's able to pick up, one practically solo.
We'll relocate top.
Alright, look for the other opening, it's XY, EG. Exploiting the beauty that is that first level 6 on Io, but just that quick maneuverability from the Blink Dagger, the relocate, let alone what's going to happen once Underlord's able to use that Dark Rift a lot better.
I mean, EG just making fast rotations, reacting very well. It's very dangerous to go for that kill underneath the bottom tier 1 tower, and Faceless know they can get the kill, but they have to commit the Shadow Dance to find the kill, which means that Slark doesn't really have an easy way to escape, get himself out of there post-kill. And that's really Faceless undoing. Losing both to get the Underlord is definitely not an outcome they were hoping for.
Yeah, and this is just propelling Samael forward. Like, he's one Mithril Hammer away. And when I say that, like, he's already got like 600 gold now towards it.
And that's before Tinker even has travels.
Like, yes.
It's insane how far ahead of Jabzi is. The solo kill, the just better laning coming out from Samael. He is destroyed this mid lane, also just the farming efficiency coming in from the jungle, the ancients as well. There's seeing a lot of this dire side TA using the two ancient camps very close to the mid lane and the shrine as well. He's had a fantastic game.
Just to observe what he's running under right now for ICE. Probably still a little bit tentative in case there is a sentry ward, but considering the creep wave is not attacking him, he knows he's fine. Fight Carapace is available, so he starts his attack on Arteezy, looking for the denial. Crit gets a silence off. The tower tonight is there from ISISI. Fight Carapace is up, but he just doesn't have the time for it. Next Y also arrives. Support is here with Nuts.
Moves from the epicenter.
Burrow strike forward, triggers off the epicenter. They really want that kill over the life still with Universe with the Dark Rift. They bring everybody in. The kick is perfect. And Arteezy will get a double kill, and they're all going home.
Very nicely played. That relocate had to come in to help and save Arteezy. The Sand King was like, all right, he's just used Rage. I can go in, epicenter him before it comes back up. And Arteezy able to get the help he needed to stay alive. Good reactions. And again, it's EG just moving around and reacting very well to the Faceless aggression. Faceless are kind of getting desperate. They're going for these risky kills. We saw the bottom lane by the T1 tower. We saw it there. Nyx goes in like 1v2 just to get a tower deny and buy some time for his team to show up. Feeds away his life for the tower deny, and that in itself wasn't really worth it in my eyes, and from there it just got worse. Ooh, with the Sanky dying.
He's gonna try and dark pack off this, and there's still Pit of Malice, and then Rolling Boulder from Crit. Silence will be there with a quick Shadow Dance. Slime tries to evade, but they just follow the little puff of smoke. No more stuns available, so Black can just TP away to safety. But he has to abandon the bottom lane, so EG can freely push this now.
Yeah, EG kind of hitting their stride now, able to start taking towers and objectives. Samael very low in the mid lane, though. Find a... Oh, will he? Okay, yeah, blinks onto the rune, and with the refraction, Sand King.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. SK. No hope of survival with that at all.
Yeah, that's what TA does.
Things are spiraling out of control. If you look at the graphs, they're pushing down and down. And when I say down, that's in favor of Evil Geniuses. Rapidly approaching the 10k mark.
Yeah, one of those, hard to blame the Sankey there. Like, he knows they're in a desperate position, and he's just fingers crossed hoping TA doesn't have a refraction up, because if you get that kill, it's a very big kill. You die, it's like, well, we're a bit further behind. We're behind regardless.
Okay, we'll get the initial silence off. There's a relocate on the way in. Zion Samael will arrive. ISISI still in the middle of it. Gets a two-man stun only, but he got revealed. It was the sentry ward that was previously planted down, so Wish Doctor for the IO. And Arteezy will actually make it a little bit more in favor of Evil Geniuses. And Samael looking to do the same. Black fights up to the shrine. Jabs will arrive with that laser miss. Samael not too happy to try and go back into this fight when he gets Faro striked up. That's a huge streak to give over to Jabs. Crim may get the kickoff. And Rolling Boulder away, but Black doesn't have the movement speed to catch up. But that's big items coming their way. That's now the Shadow Blade gonna be completely done if he can... No, he doesn't bounce!
Oh, yeah, cool, he bounced over the cliff. Yeah, that's how he got there. Very close. Jabs, boy, man, that's a big kill. Killing that TA.
But as BT's almost the Blink Dagger up for the Tinker, and once that Shadow Blade flies out to Slark, then he's going to actually have a lot better initiation too.
Yeah, it's starting to look like the all hopes for Faces will rest in the Tinker's ability to stall this game out, buy them time to farm, defending lanes, and just being very annoying and problematic because of how hard it can be to catch him this game. Spirit, we're going to probably look to go for that Blink first. TA does have Blink and Traps, but also has to match up against the laser, so Jabs can always like laser, then either Blink away, TP out.
And RT's got so much money too. Finishes up the Echo Saber to go along with the Armlet. Just the casual Blightstone, didn't want to obviously finish up anything more. Crit, extra stun, this will allow Nyxus to get hit a stun off as well. Zai wants to help out, but that Death Ward doesn't do any damage, not when Zai has tested him up. The Wish Doctor will die, Fire Strike with the double lasers, but you've got the Meg Charge available for Universe, so a lot of heal. Under the Shrine, however, Faithless, they have more. And they'll just retreat, accepting the fact they lost the Witch Doctor.
Tinker kind of ran out of steam there and quickly come back to the fight. Doesn't have the Blink Dagger quite yet. It was 50 gold short, so picking that up in a second. And then with that added mobility, finding those kills on heroes that someone like Sankey initiates on gets a bit easier. And speaking of which, Sankey needs a blink of his own. He needs to find those quick burst damage on the frontline target. But the target will no longer be able to be Sumail if he gets himself this Aegis, which should be an uncontested one.
Yeah, they just don't know. The three men smoked in, you got no vision inside the pit, there's no easy sunstrikes to use for scouting like before. But everyone is sort of missing a part from Crit, but it's too late.
Yep. Too late. With the Sand King, Nyx potentially could have gone to make a move there, but Sentry Wards were down, and you have to go in a bit blind. And without the info which EG has, it was just too risky. And the problem is now, EG with a Rage Lifestealer and a TA with an Aegis can just start taking every tower on the map.
Well, they're looking for nuts. Their Observe Ward on bottom rune was able to scout out his movement. And if anyone was there, they weren't there in enough force. Smell was going to finish up the tower anyway.
There's a very good chance EG with this Aegis take every outer tower on the map. They are definitely strong enough and can push very fast with the Deso, plus the Lifestealer with the Echo Saber Armlet. This is where Faceless will be tested, and Slark with the Shadowblade does not fight well into kind of five-man push, which is what EG can do with the Underlord plus TA, so we'll be much more likely we see split push coming out from Black, as well as the Tinker trying to delay as much as possible.
That's exactly what's happening. Black's already attacking that Tier 2 town before the get momentum, but it's middle lane. They go over on Jabs, a rolling boulder forward, and Arteezy infested up, ready to pop and attack that Tinker.
Yep. Jabs thinking he's safe there, but nice little infest gank. And
this is slightly dangerous. Universe will arrive, but there's a Blink Dagger on XY. So they are ready to fight. The Observer Ward they've got planned a little bit further to the south. We'll be able to scout out Crit's movement now as Arteezy also moving over.
Relocate up top with TA.
Man, they're gonna find nuts. Backline runner. Paralyzing cast. Quella doesn't really hit even. Attempted the Death Ward. Simple relocate. Pick off a support. Go back to objective based gaming.
Heading towards the Slark at mid, but yeah, EG getting further and further ahead with every kill and tower they're getting, and Faceless getting returned just isn't really comparing, and doesn't really feel like there's an end goal for this Slark to be able to easily fight into EG's lineup. And similarly with the Tinker, where Tinker, yeah, it's hard for him to get caught, but can he really do much? He can't engage in, he can't go aggressive with the Blink Dagger, he's always just sitting back, spamming rockets, putting his march down, staying as far away from any kind of Earth Spirit or TA initiation as possible. He stays too far back, that's where Lifestealer can just rage at the tower, TA can do the same with the Refraction, and we'll likely see EG take a few more objectives in the near future. They've taken over the Radiant side of the map, they've got wards in both jungles, and it's going to be very tough for Faceless to play out this stage of the game.
Yeah, Faceless need a break. To say it very, very lightly, they need to definitely get a break. Big pickup on the TA, a little bit of space created. Tier 1 towers need to fall, and they cannot have Nyx Assassin walk underneath the Sentry Ward. It's a bit of a no-go, and then he walks under another one, and then into the pit. No stun's available, so it will be a safe TP away to safety.
Yep. He gets the one tower, now it's TA level 18 now, so maxes out the traps, and we'll be very, very problematic to deal with once you're starting a few more levels. You get to that level 25 plus 3 refraction, and a big reason why TA has kind of risen in prominence on the recent patch is that level 25 talent. You're so hard to kill when you've got that extra damage block. Black doing what he can to just scrap together what farm on the map is available.
Five Carapace will protect Nyx Assassin, but only for a short period of time. With a tramp slow, okay, Sumail's gonna let him run away, but it's bottom lane. Black, as well as XY, locked in for the moment. Black just wants to run this off. He's actually got the Shadow Dance off, which will allow him a little bit of life to survive unless crit. Is there anything else to really throw out? Black's low for the Fire Strike and the double stun with the Nyx Assassin. This is big if they can bring him down quickly. But Universe, he's still so damn tanky. And with Sumail to the front lines, they realize there's just too much damage for them to deal with. Nyx Assassin, one more attack from Sumail, won't be able to get in time.
And Jab's got Universe, so it actually ends up being an okay fight. Jab's will be able to TP out. They lose just a Witch Doctor for two kills. You're thrilled about that if you're Faceless at this point.
Black's coming back in. They want this kill. Because Sumail doesn't have any real friends down here. Like, you understand, like, you've taken out two of the heroes. Like, there's not a lot of help to come. Relocate's still on cooldown for Zai.
He gets out of there. He had the Aegis, so you have to kill him twice, which is possible, but not easy by any means. And perhaps give an EG time to react and get teammates there to bail him out.
I suppose you can just wait for a timeout. It's not that far off. Quick Fire Strike. Yeah, that stun was not going to happen, but at least they get the rage out of Arteezy.
Will they go back in though? And with teammates nearby, Tinker having an Aether Lens, they may be considering a fight.
Oh. Pit Lord, no, the other Lord is back.
He's to the lane. Wants to make sure he's with his team for this push. And
look at that positioning of SK though. Grabs the epicenter, looks for the flank in. The Fire Strike is going to go over on a Life Sealer, but it didn't hit on Zai. They needed the Eye to connect on him with the laser, the Monster Machines. There's still some decent damage being pumped into Evil Genius. Not enough to really survive against Arteezy. Or maybe it is that Maledict is on him, but he'll protect himself under the creep. Meanwhile, on the back lines, Sumail is going ham. He's already managed to find one kill over on XY. Black will defend himself under the tier 2 tower.
It was a good impale, but the epicenter Barrow Strike just missing Io. It catches Zion and they managed to blow him up. It would have worked out great. And also the Tinker was perhaps a split second too late. Like if he Tinker's there as they initiate, they can burst that first target. Ideally the Io, the Underlord could have been an Lifestealer could have been an okay target as well, but you need to make sure he doesn't get saved by the Io. But they just didn't burst anyone down, and in theory they should have had enough damage between the Nyx, Sand King and Tinker. That first target can fall very fast, but slightly off on the coordination. It's one of those things where Faces have to be perfect because they are behind. They don't have the items. They've got to rely on their spells, their levels. Otherwise, they cannot take out these key targets.
Sentry wards are down. Black is looking for his target. Not visible just yet, but if he walks over the top of the trap, he will be. Nyx Assassin TP down to the shrine. He was very visible under the TA trap. EG aren't going to take the risk. They back out.
Just take this courier, no. What's he thinking?
Well, he doesn't really know about it. If he goes down and sees it and he hits it, then it's still like a full assault cuirass to put on put on cooldown for 3 minutes.
He had the observer there, so perhaps thought he could find a bigger kill, but not gonna get courier and Faceless put under some pressure come next Aegis here. It looks like for now they'll get that little bit of breathing room as EG play the farming game. They know their Lifestealer TA getting a lot more out of the map and will be in a good position to perhaps break high ground come Aegis number two.
Well, they'll need it. Gura is a wonderful defender. Meanwhile, the rest of Faces are just hunting. They're looking for anything they can, but EG sentry wards are always in the right place. Even this one's going to time out in 12 seconds. Universe knows he can just venture a little bit further out from the tower.
EG Faceless just haven't had the kind of fortune they did in game one finding those pickoffs. I mean, they've got the heroes like Sanking, Nyx with initiation, the Slark with the Silver Edge, but EG have been able to kind of predict and see those movements a lot better and just had that better early game as well. Setting Faceless back and forcing Faceless to play less pickoff and more kind of split push.
I was waiting for the courier to arrive. Never happened. Ended up traveling itself up to top lane.
His farm this game is not coming close to what it was last game. Still no Midas. He's looking to go back for it after the Blink Dagger, but realistically, he is miles behind some of these core heroes.
Tinkerus being such a nuisance.
And
now Black might even find a better opening. Universe actually starting up, trying to do that Dark Rift. The stun's going to be there. He stop Universe from TPing out. This will actually isolate Samael. But Samael's killing off Ice Ice Ice. A one-for-one trade-off isn't actually that bad for Faceless at the moment, but they are losing their Tier 2 tower on top.
Yeah, not the worst thing. Epicenter mid.
Yep, they jump in. Samael can lose those defensive refraction charges, making a run for the Arcane Room, but there's just no follow-up. Another Burrow Strike properly connecting. Black didn't reach him in time. And now is the mid lane, the relocate, pulling in Arteezy. Looks like a very simple poor swipe to kill off XY.
XY having a bit of a rough game, missing a few key Burrow Strikes and getting in over his head there with the relocate coming in. We'll see Faceless lose their last outer tower, which means it's time for those shrines to all fall. Black's been spotted here. There's a Warden Sentry over by the side here. It looks like he pinged it out, so he's let his Tinker know that, hey, be careful over this side of the map. Yeah, they're pinging directly on top. And
when you lose that movement speed, Slark is a great indicator for it.
One of the perhaps saving graces of Faceless is that they can deward the map without having to invest in a gem. They can just use the Slark with Sentry wards. Find themselves at least denying EG vision. They're not going to be able to get too much vision of their own up, but making sure they take away EGs does mean that they're not going to get picked off and starved out as much as they otherwise would.
This is confident from Ice Ice Ice.
He's sort of playing like that scouting Ricky Bounty Hunter type role. He's not playing the hunting Nyx Assassin, he's playing the scouting Nyx Assassin. Not expecting to get any kills here. There's no possible follow-up at all anywhere nearby. There's no Invoker Sunstrikes. The Tinker is nothing to TP onto. Blink on the Sand King and Shadowblade of the Slark on the other side of the map. So he's really just playing a scouting game. We'll find a courier. Does he go for it?
The Ooh. Courier found him.
Yeah, that's that is indeed more accurate.
Oh, EG. Simple Roshan again. They understand that there is no contest from Faceless. Faceless are all about pushing out the side lane. So a very simple, easy Aegis. They'll give it over to Samael, so again, Templar Assassin's got a bit more of a license to dive. Allows Samael to be a little bit more frivolous with his money too. Building in towards that Bloodthorn of his.
I still can't find the courier.
Black. Arteezy just used Infest, he won't have that easy ticket away. There's a rocket fly in, there goes your rage. They start with the first attack, and now in comes Ice Ice Ice. Hits it with Vendetta. They'll have enough damage with this, so there goes a huge streak. Black getting 800 gold for that with a relocate in from Zyne. They're trying to bring down Jazz. The TP, it won't be in time. Smell already got one kill in a different lane. And being dragged down to the bottom to get the extra kill on the Jazz. Black with a quick run, Sentry Ward down. They see where he goes, but they can't stop him. Well, yeah, they can't stop him, even with Zai. No dust available.
It still feels like some weird okay trade for Faceless, even though they lose two, but they kill one of the top farm tiers in the game, and even with losing a Tinker, it just feels like you need to buy time for the Aegis to expire so you can defend your high ground. Trading like two of your heroes for one of the enemies when your opponent's actively trying to gank you is not too bad.
That was quick and efficient. Everyone came in. I saw it coming, but it was the dusting time with Kick. And then just that burst damage that arrives from the Templar Assassin.
Yeah, and we'll see Black. They just want to... Faceless kind of want to play on the enemy side of the map because it keeps their building somewhat protected. Black will find the Earth Spirit, but
Universe will find Black. Yeah. Crit just turns around, gets the kicks. The Mal will come over too. There's just so much damage arriving from EG that every time Faceless go for one of these pickoffs, they arrive in force. It's global damage available.
Yeah, that awkward turnaround with Sumail showing up meant that the Slark could not get his Shadow Dance off, and now it's going to be a Bloodthorn. TP's bottom. They go looking for Sand King as well.
Oh, the Spirits will be able to connect, but they have no stuns available.
Yeah, hoping to perhaps catch him by surprise with a quick Blink Orchid from Sumail, but Sand King gets the hell out of there, and we'll see what Faces can do as far as defending their high ground now.
Well, XY does have that Epicenter level too, but with the heal coming in from Universe, it's almost completely negated.
They need to deal with this high ground more. They don't seem to be aware of its presence just yet. Now they'll see it, and question is who can actually kill it.
I think Isaac has been to do that either. He triggers the shrine. Whoa! Okay! Ah, that's one very dead Nyx. 45 seconds, he'll have buyback available.
This ward is just brutal. When you've got a TA who can blink and burst the hero with one belt.
That's a big find. They found Tinker down in the tree lines with a pit down as well. There's very almost no way the Jam can get out of this. When they turn on the magnetize too, focus over on the Slark. Nyx Assassin already brought back, but Black able to dodge that last little bit of an attack. He's running in. The sentry wards are down. So EG have that detection if Black tries to do any kind of shenanigans with that Silver Edge. And okay, Epic sends it in from XY. Then enough Templar Assassin will burn the Aegis the Immortal. And in comes Universe. Where is he going? They're actually taking him all back to the shrine. If everyone can get together, they are bailing out. Everybody's out. Everybody will regenerate and Faceless get nothing.
I mean, Sumail made a bit of a cocky play there going in the fountain, but he got bailed out hard. That was really nice. He also had a bit unlucky with the insta bash from the Slark. He wanted to try and chase down for the kill with the Bloodthorn, but Universe, great Dark Rift usage.
Great. Good on friends. XY. Actually remaining hidden.
See Aegis being lost, but it doesn't seem like it's going to slow down EG. They've still got that high ground ward. It will now get dewarded. TA's just able to blink in, burst anyone with the Bloodthorn. Does now, unfortunately, have a Ghost Scepter. Not an item Sumail ideally wants to have. Bought that just for the fountain respawn, so he did make sure he tried to not die there, but as a result, they just decide to... I don't know if he wants to buy an Ethereal Blade. It's not really a great item this game for him.
Yeah, it doesn't really seem to be that kind of like, hey, this is definitely a really great core item over on the Templar Assassin. With the way the new shop works, it's now going to be, if Sumail buys it, one of the recommended items. Everyone over 5k starts buying because Sumail did it.
Yep. Oh, dear.
Ice.
Everyone's going to start diving fountains now,
Toby. You'll feel this is a good opportunity. Action charges come up. There's a quick push out with the Hurricane Pike. XY could not get that Burrow Strike off, which he needed to make that work.
I think that would have... Oh, they didn't have relocate. If that's it, they'd relocate there. That would have backfired for Faceless, but on cooldown still. Zai has got all the support items, the Vlads, the Glimmer, the Ghost Scepter of his own. Very hard to play around these team fights if you're Faceless now with the sheer item advantage that EG have. And TA has hit that level 25 plus 3 refraction instances.
30,000 gold advantage. No wonder they got all the items up. Quick little haste room for Arteezy chasing down Black. Black will not have the movement speed to outrun him, but he has friends and a base. That'll work. This is the big timing right now for Faceless. Big defense, Jabs needs to make sure these creep waves never really enter the base. There's also that infested lifestealer back inside crit, looking for the opportunity to smell. Just walks in through the bottom lane.
Right.
He knows it's open.
Does go for the Ethereal Blade. Ton of agi from this item. Will hit very, very fast. The result.
I'm wondering who he tries to pop it on. Like,
it's... Slarking on his Dark Factor. It's just like a nice little bit of killing damage if you go on a target. And they're like getting away out of range. Just throw, maybe throw an Ethereal Blade, try to finish him off, but... Probably an unconventional item choice when you're not bursting. I mean, Slark has a lot of physical, you can always use it on yourself. The ideal outcome. Black just getting the essence chipped out. Nice little like cheap hits. Whenever he can get free hits off, he just needs to do so to start getting those stacks going.
Yep. Build it up. It's like watching ODs trying to steal intelligence before a team fight. He needs to have it, then can hit like a truck when the fight begins and not halfway through the fight.
Well, they've gone in with a Hex, but nothing to follow it up.
All he does is just rocket spam and Hex spam, but the Burrow Strike up on top hits Sumail. Zai's gonna be there. And actually hold him in position.
Hold him
now with a pit. I think Sumail actually wanted to buy, triggered his BKB. Looked to be engaging.
It was an IO defensive relocate game. It wasn't like Sumail was gonna die there. I was a bit surprised to see the relocate being used, but I think Zai just wanted to reposition him a bit. Sure, it was okay, and let's get Sumail's BKB down to 6 seconds now. Can see the potency of Faceless's draft when they're defending high ground. They're very, very strong, and whilst that first Rex does set them back, but they're not in a position where this game is entirely lost just yet. A Tinker Hex means they've got initiation to catch the Lifestealer or a TA before they pop BKB. So there's Zai who's going to have to be on point using that relocate to save teammates who perhaps get initiated on.
And also the heals from Underlord. Anything which keeps the sustain going for EG, their start of space is getting what they're looking for. As you said, all they want to do is find just that one quick pick off from a heavy control coming in from Jabs. Now Abyssal Blade is fully completed on Arteezy, so speaking of control, he's got it in droves.
He's got...
Black actually stopped building his. He was looking at it at the very start, Now he's actually turning his attention towards the Skadi.
Wants to be able to hold his own against the TA and lifesteal a bit better, having the slow from the Skadi as well as all the extra stats. That means he can go toe-to-toe with those two carries a little bit better. Bastion itself has been very good. Every time I've seen Shamel pop BKB, you just getting instantly bashed. Same for the lifesteal when he rages. This Bastion has been a value pickup, and the Abyssal, yeah, it's a guaranteed bash as well, but it seems like he's getting enough value just from the Skull Basher that he can invest into. Actually goes to BKB, not Skadi. Interesting. Wants to be able to get out of the Bloodthorn and the Earth Spirit silence.
I would say it's more freedom to fight in the... Then Samael's the one doing all the damage at you.
Yeah, he does damage through the Bloodthorn though, so being able to BKB it off may save your life and gate some of that damage he'd normally do.
Black's running in, but that's a DD Templar Assassin. Unless you're gonna get permastuns, this is not gonna work. And a three-man kick from Crit and a two-man pit. This may be enough control for EG to at least get one of these kills and open up the mid, especially when Samael and Arteezy just combo together. No buybacks available for either. Ice, all for Black. More kicks hitting into the Witch Doctor. Samael, two hits? Yeah, two hits. That'll do the job. Moving over to XY. That's the game. We're going to a third as EG will take game two with 32 kills to the 9 of Faceless. But really just a strong performance on all lanes.
Yeah, winning the lanes as hard as they did and putting Faceless on the back foot. Slark could never really get too involved. The Shadow Blade came a bit later than you would hope for. The Sand King's early game rotations